Good evening, everybody, and thank you for joining us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. I'm your host, Chris Mascaro, and we are still on a high from last Saturday's fantastic event, the Unstoppable Gala that we broadcast live from out in L.A. We had so much fun talking to people like Bob Guinea, David Meltzer, Krista Harmoto, Tony Gonzalez, Byron Chamberlain, Nick Ferguson, and Robert Griffith. Boy, what a wonderful time we had. And if you missed the show, you can download it from our site, ThursdayNightTailgate.com. Plus on iHeartRadio, TuneIn, iTunes, Stitcher, and all the places that you typically hear the show from. So please, we hope if you missed it last week, you're going to join us. It was such a great time. Tonight, Bob and I have another wonderful lineup of guests to share with you. We've got a couple of former Steelers, which you know thrills me to no end. Plus, we've got some great friends returning, a couple of rookies, so it's going to be a great night. We're glad you're here to share it with us as well. So relax, settle in, and let us take your mind off everything else going on in your life for the next couple of hours. It's going to be a lot of fun. TNT is brought to you by former Bengals and Falcons tight end Reggie Kelly and the great folks over at Kaivin Foods. Be sure to spice up everything on your menu by adding Kaivin salsas, sauces, and spices to what you've got cooking. Check them out online at kaivin82.com. That's Kaivin, K-Y-V-A-N, the number 82.com. TNT is also sponsored by Dr. Peter Candelora and the great folks over at Coastal Orthopedics. If you're living with joint pain, stop and do what the Gridiron Grace do to get relief, and that's go to bone-dr.com and check out the wonderful folks over at Coastal Orthopedics. Plus, check out the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory. If you love baseball and you haven't been, you got to go. You got to see them at, and you can find out, you know, more information by going to sluggermuseum.com. But when you go there, you actually get to see the actual bats that major league players are going to be using in games being made right before your very eyes. You're going to see it right down the assembly line. It's fantastic stuff. So go again, sluggermuseum.com. And we also want to give a shout-out to our friends over at the Gridiron Greats organization. They're doing great things to take care of the guys who came along long before there was such thing as six-figure salaries and health care coverage. They've got a great event coming up as well in June. It's going to be an evening with Mike Ditka, Joe Green, Fred Biletnikoff, Tom Mack, Bob St. Clair, Dick Vermeil, Jimbo Covert, Jim McMahon. Great players. It's a Hall of Fame dinner and golf outing. It's going to be on Friday, June the 12th, and Saturday, June the 13th at the Silverton Casino and Hotel out in Las Vegas. I'm telling you now, it's going to sell out fast. So for more information, go to gridirongreats.org/Hall of Fame to get more information. All right, first up tonight in our 12th man segment, along with Sports One Marketing CEO and best-selling author David Meltzer, is going to be one of our favorite guests and former Chargers, Vikings, and Giants defensive back, Vency Glenn. No one shoots straighter, keeps it real more than Vency Glenn. We're going to hear from he and David here in just a few minutes. Following them is going to be one of the biggest supporters of our show, and that's former Giants fullback and member of the NFL Alumni Association Board of Directors, Randy Minniear. We're here all about the great things that the NFL Alumni Association is doing to help the former players and take care of their health issues, plus the wonderful things they're doing for children's charities across the country when he joins us about 20 minutes from now. I'm really looking forward to the bottom of the hour, though. We're going to be joined by former Steelers linebacker Robin Cole. This is going to be Robin's first time on the show, so you know how excited I'm going to be to get to talk to Robin. You know, he was there for the Steelers' third and fourth Super Bowl titles back in the 1970s. We're going to hear his stories from that time, plus what it was like to play in Pittsburgh during some of the down years in the 80s when he joins us about 30 minutes from now. Later this hour, our good friend and former Steelers and Falcons defensive back Randy Fuller is going to be back with us. We'll get his thoughts on what both teams need to be doing as they look forward to the draft and the remainder of this offseason. You know, they need to become larger factors next season. There's a lot of work that needs to be done. I know my Steelers got a lot of work to do on the defensive side of the ball. Plus, he's also got a great event coming up next month to help benefit cystic fibrosis. So So we're going to talk about all of that as well. Randy is going to be here about 50 minutes from now. Then we're going to kick off the next hour with former Broncos and Bears tight end Desmond Clark. You know that Desmond played his college ball at Wake Forest, perhaps, but what you may not know is that when he left school, he left as the all-time leader in receptions in ACC history. He was also a member of the Bears team that played in Super Bowl 41 against the Colts. So we're going to talk about his Super Bowl experience, plus, you know, playing with guys like, you know, our friend that we met last week, Byron Chamberlain, joined us at the gala last week, who was fantastic, by the way, plus our good friend Mohsin Mohammed. So we'll talk about playing alongside those guys when Des joins us a little over an hour from now. And then we're going to wrap up this show with Ronnie Brown. This is Ronnie's fourth visit with us. He split time last year between the Texans and the Chargers, so we'll see what he's planning to do with the 2015 season. Is he coming back? Is he going to play another year? We'll get his thoughts on that. Plus, you know, a little bit of information maybe from him on the Chargers and what they need to do to get over the hump to make a Super Bowl run. He's going to be here with us about 90 minutes from now. So, as always, we are wall-to-wall with great guests for you tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate, and we thank you for being here and to take the journey along with us over the next couple of hours. But before we get started, let's bring in my co-host, Mr. Bob Lazzari. Bob, how are you tonight, my friend? Bob, do I have you?
Here, Chris.
There you are. Here. All right. We almost left today. Hey, there you are, my friend. How are you tonight, Bob?
I'm doing okay. How about yourself, sir?
Fantastic. How was the birthday last Sunday?
It was, if you could draw it up, it's the way you'd like it, Chris. Me, a couple of pets, the sun was shining, and it was quiet. That's all. Didn't snow, Chris. Didn't snow. So.
Hey, there you go. That's a little bright side. No snow. God knows. You've had so much. Is it getting a little melting? Is it starting to go away? You see any patches of green?
Well, you saw the pictures posted, Chris, of these 6-7 foot snowbanks. Today,
right?
We had a 50-degree day with torrential rain. So think about it. It's there's a lot of flooding. We can't catch a break here. There's incredible flooding going on now, and just all mud wherever you step. And that's New England in late March.
Wow. All right. Well, hopefully it continues to get a little bit better. Maybe that torrential rain will help you get rid of the rest of that snow, and you guys can finally get on to some green and some warmer. At least you're getting a little warmer temperatures. Hopefully pretty soon you get to get some green grass as well. Spring is here, someone tells me. So
yeah.
Good for you, Bob.
About May 1st, Chris.
All right, we want to kick off the show like we do every week here by saluting the brave men and women serving in our military personnel and those listening in on the Armed Forces Radio Network. We want to pass along our sincere thanks to all of our veterans and everyone currently serving in every branch of the military and public service. You guys are incredible, and we thank you so much for the sacrifices that you either made as a veteran or those in serving now are making for us every day. We truly appreciate what you do to protect the freedoms that we all have and the liberty that you provide for us that allows the rest of us to do what we do. Our sincere thanks as well to Sean Cruz and all of the folks over at Armed Forces Radio. It's an honor for us to be a part of your network. You can find our show by going to armedforcesradionetwork.org. And for the veterans listening in tonight, be sure to check out globalvoiceforveterans.org. It's a great site with a wealth of information for our veterans. There's news, there's articles specifically geared for veterans out there. I'm sure you're going to find it absolutely interesting and very beneficial. Again, check it out, globalvoiceforveterans.org. And I want to remind everyone, you know, that you're listening into our show tonight, obviously, on Blog Talk Radio. You can also listen into us on Boost Radio. Our friends over there stream the show for you every Friday night from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time. If you go to BoostRadioNetwork.com and click on the on-air link in the upper right-hand corner of their homepage, you can hear us there. You can also find us on great sites across the Internet, iHeartRadio, TuneIn.com, Spreaker, SoundCloud, and iTunes. And you can take us everywhere you go with your mobile device via the Stitcher or Player.fm app as well. All right, let's kick off the show with by getting a message from our friends over at Kyven Foods, brought to you by former Bengals and Falcons tight end Reggie Kelly.
Add great flavor to your next tailgate party with Kyven Salsas. Former NFL tight end Reggie Kelly created these salsas for dipping chips and much more. In hot and mild flavors, Kyvan salsas make a great marinade. They are terrific in meatloaf and are super toppers for everything from baked potatoes to scrambled eggs. It's a great ingredient to enjoy in a variety of family favorite meals. And some people say Kyvan salsa is a meal to itself. With all the possibilities, Kyvan is truly salsa with soul. Kyvan salsas are also made from natural ingredients, and they are preservative-free. So look for Kyvan, that's K-Y-V-A-N, at area Walmart stores or online. Click on the Kyvan logo on our website to check retail and online locations. More information at Kyvan82.com.
If you want your guests to be raving about your next house party or your next tailgate party, baseball season getting underway, folks, opening day just about a week and a half away, be sure to serve them plenty of Kyvan food, salsas, sauces, and spices to liven up everything you're going to put on your menu. Be sure to check out their recipes. You can find them on our site, ThursdayNightTailgate.com, as well as their own site, Kyvan82.com, and give them a like on Facebook. That's important to them, too. Kyvan is K-Y-V-A-N, the number 82.com. You're going to appreciate the goodness. All right, folks, now joining us on the Kyvan Foods guest line in our weekly 12th Man segment is Sports One Marketing CEO and best-selling author David Meltzer, and his special guest, a great friend of ours, former Chargers, Vikings, and Giants defensive back Vince Glenn. Good evening, fellas.
Good evening. How are you?
Oh, fantastic.
Good.
You?
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, I'm great. I'm hoping my boy Vince Glenn is great. How are you, Vince? Oh, I don't have him on the line again. Anyway,
that's
my boy. I know he's dealing with some stuff, but things are going great, Chris. I really appreciate you having me on again. We had an unbelievable event honoring Warren. Over 600 people raised over $2 million. And thank you so much. Yeah, phenomenal. I mean, companies like 1111 Wine or Gallagher gave $1 million to the Unstoppable Foundation. These companies just understand abundance and how to, you know, both make a lot of money, help a lot of people, and we definitely had a lot of fun, as you know.
Yeah, no, Dave, you know, thank you so much for, you know, having us out at the event. You know, we had an absolute blast. It was a great time. You know, we had great guests, you know, that were there to be a part of the event that you guys brought over. Boy, I tell you what, you know, the opportunity that, you know, not only, you know, talk with you, but to Bob Guinea and to Tony Gonzalez and Krista Harmoto and we had Nick Ferguson and Robert Griffith on the show and Byron Chamberlain, you know, all great guys. And boy, you know, they shared some great stories. We, you know, to your point, we had a lot of fun. So thank you for allowing us to be a part of the event. It was everything we thought it would be and so much more. And I do believe we've got Vince Glenn on the line with us now. Hey, Vince.
Hey, what's happening?
Hey, 2-5, how are you, buddy?
I'm good, pal. I miss you, man.
I have to get you on Armed Forces Radio just to talk to you. I know you're going.
I know, isn't that sad? But that's all. At least we got a link and a connection. That's all good.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the man, and you know, he is number one. Maybe 2-5 in the playbook, but number one in my heart. This guy gives everything to everyone, and he's helping a personal friend, Chris, and that's why Vince was not available. Although he supported us and brought all those great celebrities that you listed off, you know, Vince invited them and brought them to the gala, and unfortunately couldn't host them because he's helping a friend. And I wanted to have Vince on today because he didn't have the opportunity to go on at the gala, and you know, he just he represents everything an NFL player should be, and most importantly, what a friend is. So, Vince, I just wanted to come in on the air to thank you for everything you do, for all the charities we work for, for Chris and the boys on the radio, and Bob, and especially me and my family. We adore you. We thank you, and we recognize all you do for everyone else. So thank you, Vince.
I appreciate that, Dave. You know what you mean to me, and and everybody else doesn't know. It's been a tough time for me. My best friend took his life last week, so it's been real hard. And Dave and his undying support and the Sports One marketing team has been so tremendous in helping me get through this difficult time. And that's why I wasn't there last Saturday, and we're actually putting him in the ground tomorrow. So I still got a few more hours to go, you know, then I'm going to move on and move forward and help a lot of people make a lot of money and have a lot of fun, you know, because that's what my life's all about. And, you know, Dave's gave me this great opportunity at Sports One Marketing to come in and just, you know, just share me with the world and his friends and his corporate partners and athletes that him and Warren deal with on a day-to-day basis and bringing me on to this show on a regular basis. And, you know, he's meant a lot to me. And, you know, when you lose a close friend, you kind of understand what friendship really means. And I'm not talking about the people you hang out. I hang out with. I'm just talking about the real friendships in life that mean the most to you. And Dave, you know, it ain't about Sports One with me. It's all about you, man. And I appreciate the friendship. And the job is there, but the friendship means way more to me. Trust me.
I know that, and I appreciate that. And, you know, we're gonna move forward past these life incidents that happen. And, you know, one thing we all share, and we're all going to have a great celebration at, is we're all going to the Masters with the wheels up and hospitality and the wheels down party and Nick Faldo and all of these great guys. And then so you have your host of football celebrities coming.
Players,
maybe you could tell Chris a little bit about what we're doing, because you are the legend. You are Tiger's great friend. I know they're asking. I want to ask them about
that. The wheels up event is going to be a great event. You know, just, you know, it's to me, it's more like the corporate world coming together, relaxing, and having a July 4th vacation and just networking and meeting a bunch of great people and the Wheels Up partners and what we do at Sports One and the other celebrities and just the corporate partners that we're going to have there is just instrumental and huge to what we do on a day-to-day basis. So what we try to do at Sports One is just share our love with the rest of the world. You know, and that's pretty much it. If you want to simplify it, you know, we go out, and our first goal is to help somebody, to say thank you. You know, we appreciate you, what you bring to us. And Dave exemplifies that every week. Monday meetings, Friday meetings, you know, we have our team meetings, and this is something that it's not just said in his book. This is something he exudes and demands at work. And that's the beauty about Sports One. Everybody's on board. He's brought a great team atmosphere to the company, and we're striving and providing. And it's a beautiful outlet, I know, for me and just for the people that we have in our lives that we can bring in and share the great things that we do at Sports One Marketing.
Great stuff.
That's the thing. And, two, just finish real quick. I know, you know I'm blessed to be your friend, but you have the world's most famous friend, and he cares so much about you. And maybe this gives everybody. I know it's not football, but, you know, Tiger Woods is your close friend. Can you give us any insight on Tiger and his gratefulness and empathy that he has and what's going on?
Yeah, this is all I ask the world to do, man. Embrace him. You will never see anything like this in your life. You know, and I always tell people, you know, I told them a long time ago, I said I would never want to be you. I could not bear the burden of being you every day, where you have no private life, you have no life, you know, and things like that. But, you know, he's been a great friend to me for 17 years. He's a great human being. I wish the world would give him a little break. But, you know, I hope he's there, you know, at the Masters, which would make the event a lot better. But, you know, he's a friend of mine. He believes in me. My friend that I just lost, he called me and gave me condolences about that. And, you know, he's a great friend, just as Dave is to me. You know, I wouldn't put one above the other. And that's what Tiger brings. So I hope you guys come to the Masters that's listening, come out to a great event, and hopefully get to see some great golf. You know, and that's what it's all about, sharing
the
sharing.
Go. Dave, amen. Before we let you guys go, obviously, you know, this event that's going to be around the Masters, but tell our listeners again where, they can get a copy of your book, Connected to Goodness, and then where else you might be speaking over the next few weeks.
Yeah, absolutely. Speaking at the Sanctuary there in Charleston, South Carolina, before the Masters, and Vency and I will be flying back and forth into the Masters. Gracious hospitality of Wheels Up. Obviously, buy my book at Amazon. It's the best place. Come to ConnectedToGoodness.com, and we're going to be launching right before the Masters, the Meltzer Mission, and the 30-Day Gratitude Challenge. Everybody should say thank you before they go to bed and thank you when they wake up for 30 straight days. Best and easiest way to change your life. I do want to make one little note that everyone can understand is that when Vensey said that me and Tiger Woods, no one's above one or the other, that is except on the golf course, because it's obvious, that I'm the better golfer.
That's great.
Hey, I will say this. Hey, you know what? You fans out there, it's all about connected to goodness. Don't just come be a part. Get the book. Live it on a day-to-day basis, because it's a great book. It's a great opportunity to find out about you. And so read the book, get ready for the next one coming out, and many more to come. But it's a great opportunity to just stay connected to good people, to good lives, and you know, and just love of each other, fellow human beings. And I appreciate Dave for the book. Everybody at the funeral service tomorrow will have a book, because I told them you got to stay connected to goodness. So those are great things that Dave has exemplified through his book and through his daily life.
That's fantastic stuff. Vincey, you know how much we love you on this show.
Man, you know I got something for you, and I was so sad that I didn't get it. I'm going to tell the fans what I have for you. I have a Vincey Glenn signature autograph golf bag, San Diego Charger colors. I couldn't bring it to you. I wanted to surprise you and give it to you, but I'm going to let the world know. So we'll send it to you. And you got to use it. Forget the custom golf bag. You got to use the Vincey Glenn golf bag.
Oh, you kidding me? Why wouldn't I? Yeah, that's fantastic, brother. I appreciate you very much. You know how much you mean to
us. Man, you know I love you, pal.
You know how much I love you, and you know, I got my Vincey Glenn jersey right here next to me as we speak. So I look forward to seeing you here in a couple of weeks. You and Dave both at the Wheels Up Wheels Down event around the Masters. Plus Vincey, you know, you're coming back on the show on April 16th, the annual Happy Birthday to Me episode, because there isn't anyone that I would rather share that night with besides you and Dave and Bob and a few other guys. But you both mean a great deal to us. Thank you so much for being a part of the show again this week.
I will. Thank you. And I want to say this before I get off the air. And the only reason you and I are friends because we are connected to goodness. And that goodness is Dave Meltzer. So world, no, Dave Meltzer, listen to that name, that number, even if you ain't got it yet. Dave Meltzer is the reason why me and this man are good friends. It's all about being connected to goodness. And Sports One and Dave Meltzer brings that to my life. Thank you, Dave.
Thank you, buddy. Have a wonderful
evening. Dave, Vincey, thanks again for being a part of the show. Dave, we'll talk to you again next week. Vincey, you know I'm counting the days till I get to see you. Thank you so much for the golf bag, boy. I can't wait to get my hands on that thing.
Okay, fellas, you guys be good, and thank you so much.
Our
love
condolences,
you.
Vincey, too.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Take care,
good night,
guys.
Fellas. Take
good
care.
Night.
Bye-bye.
Wow. That's really something, Bob. I can't wait to get my hands on that golf bag.
Holy cow! You know, you just you log in and you get gifts. Who's better than you?
who's having a better night than me? I can't imagine anybody right this minute. But
you have to post some pictures of that bag, Chris. That ought to be something. If I know Vincey, he's got it souped up special for you. So
I'm sure he does.
Gesture.
Yeah, absolutely right. All right, we've got our next guest hanging on the line. We're going to get to him right now. Now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line is a great friend of the show and a guy who's been one of our top supporters over the years, and that's former Giants fullback and member of the board of directors over at the NFL Alumni Association, Randy Minniear. Let me give you a little bit more background on Randy. He's from Indianapolis, Indiana, was a 20th-round draft pick in 1966 by the Giants out of Purdue. Played in the NFL from 1967 to 1970 with the Giants and the Browns. Like I said, we can't thank Randy enough for what the wonderful support that he has given us, and we are so thankful to have him back with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Randy, how have you been, my friend?
Well, I'm just fine, you guys. How you guys doing?
Oh, great.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Always an honor to be with you guys. And let me say, number one, congratulations on the continued explosion of popularity of your program. It's just wonderful, well-deserved. And we thank you, as a member of the NFL alumni and as chairman of the board, I just want to say thank you for all you do for the guys of yesteryear that you have on to talk about football and sports and life and things. And we of the NFL alumni are just extremely proud to even be a small part of your program. So thank you very much.
Oh, thank you for saying all that, Randy. We appreciate it very much. So, Randy, to start off with, there are a couple of things people may not realize about the NFL Alumni Association. I want to make sure that we bring it here on the front table. One, you know, you guys do so much, you know, for the health and the welfare of the alumni players, but you guys also do a lot, you know, for kids. So talk about the charities and the things that you guys do at, you know, the different alumni chapters around the country, because there's one just about in every major city around the country. Talk about the good things that you do to help the players, you know, and their health as, you know, as they get on and, you know, post their NFL careers, plus all the great things you guys do for kids.
Well, thank you for the opportunity. We NFL alumni back in 66 started off to really try to get pensions for the pre-59ers. In fact, one of the great prides that I have is that the very first check that we gave to help pre-59ers was to the great Galloping Ghost, number 77, Red Grange. And
wow.
We went on from there, and then in the 70s, we changed it from we got pensions and helped get pensions for the pre-59ers, and we changed to caring for kids. And over the years, we have been able to raise millions and millions and millions of dollars, as you say, through our various chapters around the country. Right now, we have 30 that are active around the country. We're pushing to have one in every single city that has an NFL team. We run golf outings. We do anything we can do to help raise monies for younger people that are less fortunate than we, that need help, that we can give charitable dollars to help their organizations. Each chapter has their fundraisers, and it may be various things. Each chapter then has the opportunity on their own to give out to whatever charities they would like to give to within their areas. Most of the chapters try to find the charities where, you know, a dollar here and a dollar there means a great deal to that charity to really help them go and grow and to fund the programs that they're running. So we don't necessarily look for the national programs that have great fundraising efforts. It's the smaller programs in our own community. So it's giving back to the young people. We all have been very fortunate in our lives to have the opportunity to play pro ball and hopefully go on from there to some successes. So what it is, it's a group of retired football players and those who care about kids that have bound together to form NFL alumni and give away to kids and charities in our areas. And then a few years back, we kind of went back to a dual mission of caring for our kids and then caring for our own. So we develop programs that help our own, being able to help those that are less fortunate, that are indigent, that are struggling, where we can step in and help them get their lives back together. That's the ex-ball players and things. And then
right.
We started the Dire Need Fund in 2000. I went to the league, and Mr. Tagliabue and Pete Rozelle were kind enough to help us put together the Dire Need Fund. The Dire Need Fund has then turned into now what is the Player Care Foundation, where we take care of our own. Guys are able to come to us for help in just about any way, whether it be medical or mental or whatever ways that we can help get them back on their feet and going forward in a positive way. We help families. We help their kids. So it's been a great honor, and we're very proud of the alumni and the Dire Need Fund, because it's a volunteer organization. We're all volunteers. I've had the great honor of sitting on that board for 39 years.
Wow.
Been chairman for 17 of those 39. Supposed to be a 3-year term. I'm not sure how that worked out, but I thank you for asking, because it's something we're very, very proud of. And so many of the great names of pro football, you'd be surprised, are members of the alumni and are out there helping us raise monies for the less fortunate, both our own and kids. So that's what the alumni is all about. And then, of course, the Player Care Foundation has been phenomenal in the last 7 years of our existence of giving opportunities to those less, those indigent or less fortunate than we, and we can help them in all kinds of ways with operations. With we do a lot of research on the health and wellness of our players. We do cardiovascular screenings. We do prostate screenings. We do all kinds of things along the research lines, and yet we've been able to take guys right from screenings at our various areas around the country where we do them and send them right to the hospital and save some lives. And that makes us very proud of the work we're doing in the alumni.
That's great stuff. Randy, to that end, you know, the thing that's obviously dominated, you know, the health news has been concussions.
Yes.
Talk about the work that you guys are doing to help guys, you know, later in life as they're trying to deal with, you know, the potential side effects of concussions.
Well, through the Player Care Foundation is the main way, and of course, the Player Care Foundation is funded by outside sources, the league itself, NFL charities, and the NFL alumni. We are now funding and help fund the Player Care Foundation, and we're doing a lot of neurological screenings to see where the players stand on a baseline, and then going forward, they can come back and follow their. Hopefully, continued lack of problems, but we can catch problems if they are. We have certain hospitals that we send them to for these neurological testing, and then if there are problems, we can send them to the right places to help them with their cognitive behaviors and things that they need. So, obviously, with the upcoming hopeful settlement of the concussion lawsuit, now that it has been agreed upon, and we're waiting for the judge to come back, and we will be able to do that for every one of our ex-players, starting them off with the baseline screening and then following them, and if need be, we'll be able to give them help as they go forward. So, and then I know a lot of the guys, because we've not been able to find, listen to me like I'm a doctor, the doctors, the medical research has not been able to find, as of yet, a way to find CTE and the neurological problems in the brain until after you're passed on. I know a lot of our guys are donating their brains in their afterlife to the Boston University, I believe it is, doing these studies. So everybody that I talk to, everybody that I know that are ex-players are really working hard to see what we can do to help these guys as they go on in life. And then I know we have funded a great deal of the youth football programs and their efforts to have what we call play heads-up football. I happen to be a high school football and baseball coach, and I'm very involved with kids and teaching them the proper way to play the game to avoid the head injuries and things. And the NFL and player care and the NFL alumni are greatly behind that program and really teaching the proper way to play.
Wow, that's great stuff, Randy. Thank you so much for sharing the stories. I think that these are some things that, you know, listeners need to understand, you know, the great work that you guys are continuing to do to help improve not only just the players' lives, but the players' families' lives on top of that. It's all wonderful stuff.
Well,
questions for Randy?
Yes, Randy, staying on that same subject, Chris and I have talked to many guys who are in a position to offer help like yourself, and they all are on the same page, Randy, that a lot of the players with these so-called maladies and a lot of problems that derive from playing football don't come forward, Randy, out of maybe pride purposes or just they're incapacitated to that point. Do you find that to be a big problem, Randy, and what do you do if you find out about a person who needs help but just never reaches out?
Bob, you're 100% correct in that, and one of the major problems, believe it or not, when we first started the Player Care Foundation and the NFL alumni's work, you're right, it's finding these guys, and I don't, I'm like you, I don't know whether it's pride or what. I will tell you this, that if they come to the Player Care Foundation, names are never given out. We don't use their names. In fact, one of the jobs that I have on a player care is Andre Collins and I are the two that okay certain amounts of money that are given to help guys or certain bills that are paid and things like that. We do not even ask. Our rule is, Andre's my rule is, we don't want to know who it is. Give us the background, give us the problems, and we will help. I think there is a sense, Bob, I think you're right, of embarrassment. There shouldn't be because we've all, you know, had problems in our lives. None of us are free of that. And what I want guys to understand, number one, if you know someone that's out there that we haven't reached yet, or they don't understand it, help them. Get them on the NFL website, the NFL alumni website, look up Player Care Foundation, bring their names to us, and we will then reach out to them. We're doing more and more of that now, where someone does not want to, we'll reach out to a family member. We'll go to them and say, hey, can we help? How can we help? But the hardest thing is Ray, is finding some of these guys. So we have to depend on, and this is a great opportunity that you're giving the NFL alumni and the Player Care right now to be on a program like yours that is so widely heard. If people know of a guy and there is a reluctance on his part to reach out for whatever reason, embarrassment may be exactly right, Bob, I'm not sure, but let us know. Bring the name to us. Let us find a way that will be proper and not embarrassing to the player to call a wife or a sibling or something and say, hey, we'd like to help. We're here for our teammates. You know, this is football, one of the great games. I love the game of football, and we're all brothers. We're all warriors that have played the game in the past. Obviously some much better than I, in fact, let's say most much better than I, but let us know if you know someone and a program like this helps us. So I thank you for asking that question, and I hope guys can get over any kind of embarrassment. You know, everybody in their lifetime has problems, and as long as they know that we're all brothers in arms, we're all here to help each other. It's one of the great pride things that I have in my life, that I'm a member of a fraternity that seems to always want to help and always want to give back and take care of their brothers.
And Randy, you would be the perfect guy to ask, and you've probably been asked it already about the Chris Borland walking away from the game, an incredibly talented football player who excelled on the field last year and can walk away from something you know he loves, and maybe he's walking away, Randy, just basically in order to enjoy it more. He's seen a lot of the problems. Can you fault him at all, Randy, for what he did?
Not 1 minute, sir. Not one minute. I think that we all make decisions in our life when we know that something could be dangerous, that there are possibilities of injuries down the line, and especially with the brain injuries that we haven't been able to solve as of yet. In a way I admire him for believing strongly enough that he wants to go on and not take those chances in life, and he can walk away from a lot of money and say, I don't regret it. I had my opportunity. I made it to the level I wanted to make it to. So no, I don't fault him at all, Chris. I really don't. I think that you know, each one of us has to make that decision. I think in anything. I mean, if you are in any kind of a sporting position or anything in life that there is some danger to, I think each of us have to stand up and say I do or don't want to do it. And I admire him for having the courage to walk away from what was in front of him.
Randy, we recently lost Hall of Famer Chuck Bednarik. He played with the Eagles from 49 to 62. You didn't come into the league until a few years after that, but I was curious, did you ever get a chance to meet or talk with Chuck?
I had numerous occasions to meet Chuck, and I'm going to tell you, first of all, the man had the biggest hands I've ever seen in my life. Had I met him before I was drafted, I probably wouldn't have played pro football. He was that big. He was a tough cookie. And, of course, as you're well aware of, there was that incident between he and Frank Gifford, and Frank's right. A dear friend, and yet there were never any hard feelings between them. So many times we'd have a golf outing or something, and Chuck would come up to Connecticut or to New York and spend time with, you know, Frank and all of us. So a great man, I think a great loss to you know, the game of football and the history of football. I found him to be one of the most delightful men I'd ever met, very kind. He was tough on the field, but he was a gentleman. A real gentleman in all aspects of his life.
Randy, when you played, you know, with the Giants, your home games were played in Yankee Stadium back then. What was
it
like the first time you walked into Yankee Stadium to play a game as a Giant?
Almost unbelievable. Walking down the ramp from the Yankee you know, the clubhouse. Of course, we shared it with the Yankees. So we came down from the locker room and down into the dugout. And I remember walking. You come through the dugout, and there's three steps up to the field. And I remember just standing in that dugout thinking, I can't believe, number one, I'm here. And looking up and down and just thinking of the men that had sat on that bench from the Yankees and then the guys that had taken this field from the Giants. It was awesome is the only word I can think of. It just was absolutely incredible. And coming out on that field and standing there and that out in Monument Field, that was, of course, when Monument Field wasn't covered by anything. It was out in the middle of the outfield. And there we were playing in Yankee Stadium. It was just incredible. It's something I'll never forget as long as I live. And I do remember we used to we'd always come out for a game or whatever, and we'd come right onto the goalpost, and we'd start doing our jumping jacks and our – you know, our exercises and our stretches and things. And I remember the first game I came out with Browns, and I came out through their dugout, you know, and up on the steps, and I'm out there doing jumping jacks. And I looked around, and none of the other players were doing anything. They didn't stretch before the game. They came back in the locker room, and here I was, this idiot out there doing jumping jacks under the goalpost with no one else doing it. But typical. You know, an experience like that is the crowd. Somebody did say to me my rookie year, what do you think of playing in front of, 80,000 people? And I said, well, in all honesty, that doesn't do anything for me because I played at Michigan, 101,000,
right.
And I played at, you know, some huge stadiums in college. But the atmosphere and the history, there just isn't any place like the old Yankee Stadium. Nothing
right.
like it.
In the first couple of seasons in the NFL, you played for Allie Sherman there with the Giants. What was Allie like as a head coach?
I'll be very honest with you. In my opinion, I think Allie Sherman probably knew more football than any coach I've ever been around. Knowledge, X's and O's, strategies, defenses, offenses. He was, and I love Allie to death, and I've told him this personally. I think Allie's problem was that he wasn't the communicator that was a Lombardi or a Landry and those guys. I think he had a little bit of a problem communicating with us as players. And that's not, you know, a knock on his character. It's just that's just the way we kind of felt. And maybe it was because I came right near the end of Allie's career when the singing has started, as well, you know, goodbye Allie and things, and he was under a lot of pressure. He still is a dear friend of all the guys who played with him. I mean, we see Allie every once in a while, or saw him up in New York and things, and always well respected and a very knowledgeable guy, very knowledgeable. And but I just don't think he was the communicator that some coaches I've seen over the years.
Mm-hmm. Bob Moore for Randy.
And Randy, when I think of fullbacks and the old running backs like yourself who kind of took a secondary role but would do anything to help a team win, those are, in my opinion, those are one of my favorite kind of players to watch. You know, the John Coons type from Green Bay right
yep.
now. When you watch the game today, Randy, I'm sure you must get just as much satisfaction of watching these fullbacks just plow into the line or make a good springing block than some of these outrageous catches we're seeing, like Odell Beckham. I'm sure a guy like yourself is still a trench guy, no?
No, without question, without question. Now, in my day, we did do a lot more running of the ball than the fullbacks of today, but I'll tell you one thing. We were expected to block like you better be able to block or you don't play, you didn't play back then, so you had to do two things. But I watched these guys today, and so many of them that are just tremendous blockers. They can run the ball when required, but they can catch the ball out of the backfield, which you see so much because that's kind of unexpected by the linebackers. But the blocks they throw just thrill me. I mean, they stick their head in there and open holes and kind of are unsung heroes. But you know what I'm noticing now? More and more on television, they do go back and they'll show, watch Coons or watch these guys throw that block that springs the back for a long run. So it's exciting to me. I mean, to me, that's the way you play the game. If you can't do everything, I sometimes I I think back in the day I played, we didn't have as many specialists, and you had to do everything. So a guy who can do several things and do them so well, and especially a guy who blocks, because be honest with you, throwing a block in the defensive line or into a linebacker is not fun. I can think of a lot of things I'd rather do than that. But, boy, these guys today, they just do it, and they do it, and they do it. And they don't get a lot of press for it. You know, it's the other guy that they spring to the long run that gets the publicity. But, you know, that's one great thing I think about football. I try to teach my high school kids this, that it doesn't go up on the scoreboard that so-and-so scored a touchdown. It goes up on the scoreboard as the Giants, the Browns, the Bengals, they scored. And it's a great team game because you depend upon every guy to do his job for your successes. And you need to be able to get in the trenches and look next to you on either side or whatever it is and know that I can depend upon this guy to do his job so I can do my job so we as a team can win. I think one of the very few true team games where one man can't do it all. And that's the great thing about football, in my opinion.
And Andy, you got the opportunity to play with so many great quarterbacks. You played with Bob Greasy at Purdue. You played with Earl Morrow in the NFL. You played with Fran Tarkington in the NFL. Talk about those three guys and the opportunity to play alongside them.
It was an experience that I couldn't believe. When Greasy came in, we had recruited one of the top high school quarterbacks in the country. And so we thought we were set. And then Bob came in my sophomore year. And of course, freshman couldn't play then. And during the summer between his freshman and sophomore year, he just worked so hard and became such a great quarterback. And you know, nothing really that you could say stood out. He didn't have a Terry Bradshaw arm. He didn't have a Steve Young speed. He just did everything well. He didn't make many mistakes. It was a great honor to play with him. And in fact, I had the opportunity to see Greece not too long ago at a golf outing, and they asked me to say a few words, and I told them, I said, you know, I'm 5 years in the NFL, 30 years or 40 years, whatever, on the NFL alumni board, chairman, and all that. I went through what the few accolades I have, and I said, Bob, you know, that my claim to fame is still that I was Bob Greasy's fullback at Purdue. So it's the only claim to fame I have. And then coming in and playing with Earl, just a man a lot like Greasy. Didn't have anything that would stand out to you, but just was a winner. And, you know, 23 years. In my opinion, that man should be in the Hall of Fame. As one of the great quarterbacks of all time, with his longevity, how many teams did he lead to the Super Bowl? I mean, a lot of people don't, you know, if you ask them who led the Dolphins to the undefeated season, they would say Greasy. Well, Bob broke his ankle second game.
Right.
And Earl came in and led him up to the championship game before Bob came in. So and what a wonderful man. We just lost him a year or so ago. And a great friend, but what a class act, but smart, so smart. I mean, the great story when he came in the huddle with 13 seconds left to go and he got down on one knee and said, everybody, if there's one you-know-what guy in this huddle doesn't think we can win this thing, they were down six, then I want you to get off the field right now. And by gosh, he led them in 13 seconds down and scored and they won. But he was a great leader. And then, of course, Fran. I mean, Fran, I love the death. Just the scrambler running all over the place. I mean, we'd have 16 pass patterns. You'd run out, and if he ran left, then you'd run left. If he ran right, I'd so tired sometimes running back and forth across the field because he was scrambling, almost killed myself. But he was a great leader also, and obviously a Hall of Fame quarterback, and really a wonderful guy, a great motivator. And you know, he still to this day does a lot of motivational speaking. And if you ever get a chance to hear Fran do a motivational speech, it is so worthwhile. But, I mean, that's a treat of my life, being able to play with three guys like that that just were incredible people, incredible leaders, and incredible quarterbacks. I mean, it was I got very, very lucky, guys. I really did. And you know, it was fun. It was fun.
No doubt. I tell you, you know, you mentioned the undefeated season. That's one of the things, Randy, that I've always sort of shook my head about is that, you know, poor Earl – to your point, came in early in the season. He's the guy who led them all the way to the Super Bowl.
Yes,
and then And then Greasy goes in to win the Super Bowl. I often wonder, you know, of all the things that, you know, and Don Shula, what a great coach he was and all of that sort of thing. You got to wonder, you know, how many times out of 10 would he have made that call? Or is that something he looks back on and thinks, you know, maybe I did Earl a little disservice there by not letting him finish off, you know, the great work that he had done.
That's a great question, Chris. I've had the opportunity to know Don, and it's fine. You're right. I wonder if he ever does look back and say, gee, was I fair to a guy like Earl to bring Reese back in? But, of course, I'll tell you one thing. You never heard Earl Morrill, first of all, say a bad thing about anybody, but never complained about his backup role for most of his career. Never complained. He was always ready when you need him. Let's go in the game. Let's win it. You know, the title of that I've seen, the greatest backup quarterback of all time. Well, you know what? I think maybe the Hall ought to take a good hard look at that, because that to me may be one of the toughest jobs in the world, to sit on that sideline and do statistics, do whatever. And if you see that guy come limping off the field, the starter, and you better be ready to go in there and play. And Earl did that time after time after time, and with great success and with great honor and with great enthusiasm. A great leader, really great leader.
That's great stuff. Randy, before we let you go, let our listeners know how they can get involved with the chapters. Like I said, you know, you've got chapters in just about every major city across the country. For those that want to get involved, that may want to get involved in a golf tournament, in an event to support children, an event to support some of the alumni players, how can they get more information and do just that, get involved?
You can go on to the NFL website. And there is a, what do you call it, offshoot? Listen to me on my computer thing, where you can click on NFL alumni. We have an NFL alumni page of our own. It will list out on our NFL alumni page all the chapters around the country. It will tell you the presidents and the contacts at each of our chapters around the country. There will be a page that will list out the major events that each chapter is having, the date, where it's being played. We do and look for what we call associate members that are non-professional football player members. Most chapters have a great many of them who are doing tremendous work to help us raise our funds and do things. They're just guys who want to be a part of an organization like ours, to meet the guys, the football players, and then work alongside of them to raise money for kids and our own. So you can get all the information right on the NFL alumni website. And just contact the president of the chapter. Find out if they have a contact number, which most every one of them do, and give the president or the contact a call and say, hey, I'm interested. I'd like to be a part of the NFL alumni. We're just a group of guys who care, want to give something back to the communities, to kids, to help our own who are hurting. And we'd love to have anyone, male, female, who wants to be a part of it and wants to take a role in doing it. And I'll tell you, it's a great thing. You get a lot of fun out of it. We have a lot of fun, and we have various events throughout the year. We visit charities. The Indianapolis chapter of the alumni this year will have 47 events.
Wow.
That includes visiting hospitals, playing basketball for kids' schooling, doing speeches, a clay shoot, a sporting shoot. A golf tournament. We spent 6 days out at the Indianapolis 500 at the what's called the Kids Zone, where we brought dummies and footballs, and the kids come through and we show them how to carry a ball and hit dummies, and they just have fun. We're very, very active, and many of our chapters are. So anyone who cares to become a member and become a part of our group, we would love to have them. They are great help, and we have a great many people who have joined and are a great part of our programs. So I thank you for asking that, and go online and find us. Everything's listed on that website, so we'd love to have them.
That's fantastic. Randy, thank you so much for continuing to be a part of the show. It's always so great to get to talk to you. You've got such great stories. You guys are doing such great things at the NFL Alumni Association. We hope you'll come back and join us again soon.
I would be there for, for, for you two anytime that you need me for anything. Again, we are very, very proud of the NFL alumni, and I speak for each of and every one of our members, both professional and associate and whatever. We're very proud to be associated with the Thursday Night Tailgate, and you two, you've done us up proud, and you've certainly helped us get our word out there, and we'll love you forever for that, guys. And I continue success. If there's ever anything, any guys that come on your program, gentlemen, that need help or that know of someone, don't hesitate to have them get in touch with me and or you guys call me and say, hey, I've got a guy that we found out through one of our guests that is hurting or something. We'll reach out to them and help.
That's great. Thank you so much for that, Randy.
Guys, well, thank you so much for letting us be a part and be a partner of yours. We really appreciate it, guys. God love you both.
All right. Thank you, Randy. We'll catch up real soon.
Hey, do guys, I hope to talk to you. And, hey, send me a picture of that golf bag, too. I want to see that. That sounds wonderful. And then, hey, don't forget, you two, come down and play golf at my place. So, you know, at our golf resort here outside of Indianapolis. We'd love to have you come down and spend a few days and play a little golf.
Ah, thank you, Randy. We'll take you up on that.
Yeah, you're my guest.
Thank you, Randy.
Take care, man.
Take care.
All right. Okay, good night, guys.
Good night. I'll tell you what, Bob, it doesn't get any better than the way this show has got kicked off. I'll tell you that right now.
Well, he's one of those guys. He's just his attitude is contagious, Chris. He's such a positive guy and he's doing so what he should be doing in his position. And my goodness, he's aware of the needs of all the other players out there that we talk about very often on this show. So he continues to do great work, and you just feel much better when you get off the phone with Randy. He's a great guy.
Absolutely right. All right, we've got our next guest, another Randy. Randy Fuller, former Steelers and Falcons defensive back. We're going to get to Randy right on the other side of this word from our friends over at Coastal Orthopedics.
Are you suffering from chronic pain in your shoulders, hips, knees, or wrists? Tired of living life with an old injury that just won't go away? If you answered yes to either of these questions, we can help. At Coastal Orthopedics and Sports Medicine, Dr. Candelora and his fine staff of medical professionals will get you back on the road to recovery. Their state-of-the-art facility and attention to detail will ensure you will be enjoying life again and feeling invincible in no time. Since 1991, Dr. Candelora and Coastal Orthopedics have been specializing in joint replacement, arthritis, and osteoporosis care, as well as pediatric and adult general orthopedics. Visit us on the web, www.bone-dr.com, or call our Newport Richey office just north of Tampa at 727-848-1417. Proud sponsors of Mike Ditka's The Gridiron Greats Assistance Fund.
This is Reggie Kelly, former Cincinnati Bengals and Atlanta Falcons tight end, and you're listening to TNT, Thursday Night Tailgate. Brace yourself for the explosion.
Now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line is Randy Fuller. Let me remind you about Randy's background. He's from Griffin, Georgia, which is just down the road from me here in Atlanta. He was a fourth-round draft pick by the Denver Broncos in 1994 out of Tennessee State, where he was a four-year letterman and an All-American defensive back. Played six seasons in the NFL for Denver, Pittsburgh, Atlanta, and Seattle. And like I say, every time he joins us, he's forever going to live in my heart and the hearts of Steelers fans for breaking up that Hail Mary pass from Jim Harbaugh in the last seconds of the 1995 AFC Championship game versus the Colts. Also was a part of the Falcons NFC Championship team in 1998, and he, too, has been a great friend of the show, and we are so happy to have him back with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Randy, how you doing, my friend?
Hey, Bob, Chris, man. It's great to be back with you guys.
Thanks.
So, Randy, before we get into, you know, what's going on around the NFL with our Steelers and that sort of thing, you've got a big event coming up next month in Nashville. Talk about what you're doing.
Okay, like the previous Randy just mentioned, golf is in our blood. I have been playing in a golf tournament for the past 4 years that has raised a lot of money for the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation. Because I was showing up every year, I actually teamed up with the organization called Cure for Our Friends. So Cure for Our Friends is run by Vera Smith, and she pretty much has decided to branch out and raise money for the CF Foundation, but she also wants to branch out to just helping people who are having other illnesses or sickness or disease, because every time we look around the corner, there's somebody else that's dealing with something else. So not only do we help the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation, we're committed to helping others as well. So our golf tournament is April 18th, 1:30 shotgun start. We appreciate you guys, first of all. Vera did tell me that you guys donated to the cause, and that's definitely going to help us reach our goal. So we appreciate Thursday Night Tailgate for being a part of it. Even though you guys won't physically be there, we definitely appreciate the help.
Yeah, so, you know, we're a hole sponsor now. Andy, you got to do me a favor. I want a good hole, maybe number two or number nine in honor of you. Since you were 29, number two or number nine, I think, should be the hole that we get to sponsor.
I'll make that happen. Don't worry. And I'll take a picture and send it to you.
Yeah, that's what it's about. I need a picture of you now by the sign that says Thursday Night Tailgate, and, you know, that we're sponsoring
Absolutely. That
hole. So.
That's done.
All right. Now, again, like you said, I know you love golf, right, and you got this golf event, so you got to tell us. What's the status of your game right now, Randy?
I told you last time I took a set of golf clubs with me to Tennessee State when I was a freshman, and, I was shooting, in the high 90s, and, 25 years later, I'm shooting in the high 90s. I mean, I'm consistent. My game is consistent. I'm the most consistent golfer
go.
I know.
All right.
I do it
so,
for fun.
don't we all? God knows. So, Randy, I need your help now. I need your help understanding what's going on with our Steelers. They've done almost nothing in free agency outside of bringing in D'Angelo Williams, who's going to back up Le'Veon Bell and probably start in his place for the first couple of weeks when he's suspended. But no
right.
defensive help, brother. No, nothing. You know, we weren't doing really well at the linebacker position, particularly on the outside, trying to get any pressure on the quarterbacks. Nothing at the defensive back. So unless you're going to be dusting off the 29, I need some help understanding what's going on.
All I can tell you is we have this conversation every year in some kind of way. We find a way to get into the postseason. So, hey, if it's not broke, hey, just let it happen. Let them do what they do. They're good at it. We have excelled in the draft in finding quality players, and the young players will come along. So I feel confident that, I'm more worried about the schedule more so than the players.
Is that right?
We got a tough one. It's going to be tough. It's going to be tough. But if anybody can handle a tough schedule, it's the Steelers. But, I'm just more concerned about if we do get banged up, do we have enough depth to not drop off? So,
right.
So hopefully we will have, having a young team, those guys can recover a lot faster than the old guys. So, we'll see. We're going to trust the system on this one.
So, and I know you've been around the team, Randy. I know you were, the Falcons, the Steelers and the Falcons played each other last year. I know you've been around the team, whether it's at training camp or sometimes on the road, this or that. When you've seen some of the young players, what's a ray of sunshine you can give a guy like me that says, hey, I think this guy's going to develop. I think that guy's going to be okay.
I think our foundation is has been built since I joined that team. Definitely been built on the linebacking core, and the core of the linebackers will continue to develop. I talked with Cesarian Jarvis while I was at a game when they came and played the Titans, and I just reminded them of the Steeler tradition, and they embraced it, and I feel like they understand, especially it's going to be a little different having a new coordinator called the defense. But, if you're looking at it from outside in, you understand that we got to have pressure. That's the way we win. And so with the speed and the agility that those two guys bring, I feel good about that. And, of course, having the veteran, James Harrison, back with the team, continuing to give those guys the inside scoop on what to do. It's going to help us as well. So, you know, it starts there. It starts with the linebacker group. I mean, even when we play, I thought the guys I played with, the DBs, I thought we were an excellent group, but we became even better because of the guys we had in front of us, which included a great linebacking core with Kirkland and Lord and Green and Brown and Gilvin. Oh, gosh. I mean, the
right.
list goes on. But then we also had, you know, Ray Fields and Briston Buckner and Kevin Henry and Joel Steed. I mean, gosh. We just had a great front. So it was easy on the back end to look good when you had such a great front on the front end.
Mm-hmm. Bob, questions for Randy?
Hey, Randy, it's a pleasure to speak with you again. I was looking through your stats and bio again this afternoon, and I try to pick up things that we haven't talked about. And I came across the fact, Randy, that when you were at William Spencer High School, one of their alumni was Otis Sistrunk. Now, Otis
yes.
Sistrunk, Randy, was the scariest guy I've ever seen. Never mind players or just the scariest
Absolutely.
Human being I've ever seen back in the day. Now, I know you were a very young young guy when he played in the NFL,
right.
but I remember him in the 70s wrecking
yep.
havoc in Oakland and just being so scary. Just wondering if you ever crossed paths with him and spoke with him later in life.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. You know, Spencer High, if you ever go back and look at the number of former NFL players or in current probably that has played at Spencer, we have quite a few. So you actually learn the name of guys who played before you. And Otis Fitzgerald was one of those guys that I actually knew his name when I left to go to college. So when I got drafted to Denver, we played in an American Bowl football game, and we played over in Barcelona, Spain. So we get over there, and we're playing the Raiders. So Al Davis had brought back all the alumni from the Raiders that was on the championship team and brought them over to Spain. And that was my first time having a chance to meet, I still call him Mr. Sistrunk. And you're right. He still was scary as ever. He still looked like he could play. But I got a chance to meet him then. And then he actually moved back to Columbus. So in my off season, he was working on the military base, and we would go play basketball, and I would have a chance to talk to him then. But you're right. He was an excellent player and an incredible person as well. So I did get a chance to meet him and get to know him a little, and you know, we're definitely proud of everything that he accomplished from a Spencerian standpoint.
Absolutely. I would call him Mr. Two, Randy, anytime I walk in. If it ever happens, I'm not Otis to me. But Randy, I like to
Absolutely.
Ask guys, especially this time of the year, guys who played in the game, what their off-season regimens were like. What were you doing, Randy, like back in the 90s, say at the end of March, as far as training regimens? What were you doing?
I was just fine-tuning. I mean, you know, I had
yeah.
been through the bowl game, had been through the
Did we lose you?
No, I'm here.
Okay. I thought we lost you.
Can you hear me?
I got you.
Yep. Okay. Yeah, so, you know, after going through the pro day, which was the pretty much the final piece and just waiting for the draft at that standpoint, depending on who the player is, of course, you get to go and visit some of the NFL teams that are considering drafting you. So, for me, I visited the only one team, which was the Broncos. And ironically, they drafted me. So I thought that was really cool that the one team that brought me in did. They said they was going to draft me, and they drafted me. So I always will have a special place in my heart for the Broncos. And but outside of that, I mean, just, you know, keeping up my physical condition and, you know, doing some weights, making sure my shoulders could hold up for those big hits that I knew I was going to have to make. And being able to run fast, you know. I got to Denver, and I had to cover Anthony Miller every day, you know. And that,
yeah.
at that time, considered one of the fastest guys in the NFL
yeah.
at that time. So, yeah, so that's what guys are doing. You know, they're anxious and they're, you know, sweating and, you know, just ready for the process to be over. You know, it's a long, long process. So you just wait patiently. And then for me, around this time, I mean, I pretty much was getting ready to graduate. So I kind of got drafted 1 week and walked across the stage the next week. And I had two of the best weeks that a guy can ask for. So it's definitely a special time of year.
So, Randy, you played with the Broncos, you played with the Steelers, you played with the Falcons and Seahawks back in the mid to late 90s. I'm just curious, was there a markedly different culture among those four different teams?
You know, I mean, I have this conversation all the time. Things have changed a lot, you know. When I was with Denver, when we first started out, when we were going on a road trip, I remember we would have a roommate. I was like, oh, yeah, this is just like college, you know. Then I got to Pittsburgh, and we would have them every Saturday night before the game at 7 o'clock. You had to be there. And then I got to Atlanta. We practiced Saturday morning, and the next time we saw each other was game day. And I love that. And then Seattle, Mike Holmgren had his handprint on everything, and you pretty much couldn't sneeze. You know, it was just a really tight ship there. So they all was different with their freedoms as far as the organization and what they did to get ready for a game. But again, all of them had success. So I can't say one system was better than the other system. But the consistent thing was that, you know, everybody bought into the team and bought into the program. So, I mean, you know, again, I always tell people, I mean, if I take away Denver, my rookie year where Elway just didn't have a great year and we were so close to even still making the playoffs, you know, all I knew was playoff football. So every team I was on, we went to the playoffs. So I was fortunate enough to always think that I was going to be in the postseason.
Was your transition into the NFL at all overwhelming for you because you came from, you know, a smaller school and then suddenly now, you know, you're not only in the NFL, but, you know, you're in Denver?
You know, Tennessee State, I mean, you know, when everybody else was practicing twice, we probably was practicing three times, you know. You know, for everybody who backpedaled and flipped their hips once, you know, I did it 10 times. So from being ready, I mean, I was ready. I mean, I played 10 games as a rookie, and I picked up the system pretty fast. And Tennessee State prepared me and had me ready. So I do take my hat off. And, of course, I had the legendary coach, Joe Gilliam Sr., the father of Jefferson Street, Joe Gilliam.
Right.
So, you know, we have a long history of, you know, Tuthall Jones, Richard Dent, now Claude Humphrey. So,
yeah.
I mean, we got Hall of Famers from Tennessee State. And if you just think about it, those guys, they came and played. They didn't come sit the bench. And so that tradition continued. And, you know, and the guys I had to guard, I mean, I know you don't talk about them a lot because sometimes there's a bunch of NFL players that played the game and did well and people just don't talk about them. But a lot of my teammates, the receivers I had to cover, which a guy named Marcus Dowdell or Patrick Robinson, you know, these guys played in the NFL, and I had to cover them every day. And it was hard. It was hard. They didn't like going against me, and I didn't like going against them. And we pushed each other.
Speaking of, you know, to cover some great players, right? When you were with the Falcons and you guys played in the 98 NFC Championship game, you guys played against the Vikings. You guys were underdogs. Vikings were 15-1 that season. Maybe had the most prolific offense of all time with Randall Cunningham and Chris Carter and Randy Moss and you know, Jake Reed. Talk about
Robert
trying
Smith.
To cover. What was it like trying to cover those guys?
Oh, man. You know, I mean, of course we had to double Randy Moss, you know, and I didn't want to be on either end of that. I didn't want to be in front of them or on top of them, right? So thank God I didn't have to do that. But I still had the next hardest thing to do, which was pretty much cover Chris Carter in the slot, okay?
Yeah.
So my hat is always going to go off, first of all, to the defensive line that gave us a heck of a pass rush that game, all right? Because, I mean, Chris and I battled the whole game, You know, he had some catches. I had some breakups. And we battled. We battled and we fought. I ended up winning more than I lost that day. And if I had to wake up and do it the next day, I wouldn't want to, you know, because he's a great player. And that was probably the hardest task I had in those 6 years of playing, was to have to cover Chris Carter for a whole game.
I bet.
But I survived. I survived, and we found a way to win. You know, that was what a great offense as well. But I think we were just a bunch of guys trying to find our place and get some recognition, because we had a bunch of free agents that joined the Falcons, and nobody really knew much about this team. And I remember the Georgia Dome being half full when we started. And then I just remember playing the 49ers in the last game in the Georgia Dome and just seeing it packed to the ceiling. And when we won that game, that gave us momentum we needed to go into Minnesota and find a way to win.
Randy, before we let you go, first of all, the event is Cure for Our Friends to benefit the Nashville Cystic Fibrosis Chapter in the Vanderbilt Children's Hospital. Go to Cure for a Friend. Yep. CureForOurFriends.org to register or become a sponsor. It's Saturday, April 18th at Pine Creek Golf Course outside of Nashville. Tell our listeners as well, Randy, how they can follow you both over social media and online.
It's actually at Wintree Golf Course.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And, so, you know, I always tell people just find me on Facebook for now. That's the best way to find me. I don't do a lot of other things with other social media, but, you know, I would definitely post some things every once in a while on Facebook. So, you know, you guys know how to find me. I still keep a low profile. I just like helping people, you know, don't want a whole lot of recognition, just want, you know, people to benefit and have every opportunity that maybe we didn't have, and just give all these different people with different illnesses a chance to live a long and healthy life.
That's fantastic stuff. Randy, thank you for joining us tonight and for the work you're doing for that fine organization and a wonderful cause and a wonderful event coming up. We hope you'll come back after the event. I look forward to the pictures of you on our sponsored hole and then hearing all about the event. We'd love to catch up with you and get a recap of how well it goes.
All right. Well, thank you guys again for having me on the show. Keep up the great work, and God bless.
All right, Randy. Take care. All the best to you and
Thanks
your family,
a lot,
my friend.
All right, take
it. Randy Fuller, again, one more time. It's the name of the cause is Nashville Cystic Fibrosis Chapter and the Vanderbilt Children's Hospital. And go to Cure for Our Friends. That's pullourfriends.org to get involved. Great stuff. Bob, you know, Randy's a great guy, always been, you know, good to us and, you know, been on the show several times, but also on our Thursday Night Tailgate Fantasy Football League, but always a lot of fun when we get to have him on the show.
Yeah, Chris, and I if you remember him playing, he was always, quote-unquote, undersized. I think he was 180 pounds wet, so you know how incredibly fundamentally sound he had to be to play among some of the Giants he played against, and He did it well, and just as good of a guy off the gridiron as he was on it. So always
exactly
love
right.
talking to Randy.
Absolutely right. All right, we've got our next guest hanging on the line for us. We're going to get to Desmond Clark on the other side of this station identification.
This is Christine Lisi, and you're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate, where NFL stars go to tell their stories with Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari on the Armed Forces Radio Network.
Now joining us on the Kyven Foods guest line is Desmond Clark. Let me remind you about Desmond's background. He's from Bartow, Florida, which is a little east of Tampa. Played his college ball at Wake Forest, where he was a two-time All-ACC second-team player and a two-time team MVP. Finished his collegiate career as the all-time leader in the ACC with 216 receptions. For 2,834 yards and 20 touchdowns. So the ACC's all-time leader in receptions. Was a sixth-round draft pick by the Denver Broncos in 1999. Played in the NFL from 99 to 2010 with the Broncos, Dolphins, and Bears. He was a member of the 2006 Bears team that played in Super Bowl 41. Finished his career with 323 receptions for nearly 3,600 yards and 27 touchdowns. And we are excited to have him with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hi, Desmond. Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari here. Thank you for joining us.
How you doing, Chris and Bob? And if you will allow me to make one small correction, because I'm very proud of my hometown. I was actually born in Bartow, but I'm from Lakeland, Florida. Back in those days, we couldn't afford to go to Lakeland Regional Hospital, so you had to go over to the next town over in Bartow. So that's where I was born, but Lakeland is my hometown, proud of, and just want them to get the credit for raising me.
Okay, very nice. So, Desmond, I want to start tonight by talking about your time at Wake Forest. You know, you played for current Lions head coach Jim Caldwell while you were there. What was it like playing for Coach Caldwell?
You know what? I've been blessed throughout my athletic career to have all good coaches. Especially all of my head coaches have been pretty good people, and I put Jim right up there at the top of the list. Coach Caldwell is a guy, especially, you know, being in college and growing into manhood, that really influenced my life on, you know, how a real man should present himself, should go about his business, and should do his work. I think even more than being a football coach, Coach Caldwell played a very important role in my life in developing me as a man.
So now that he's, you know, head coach, over in Detroit, also, you know, was spent some time as head coach in Indy. Any calls from Coach Caldwell to maybe dust off the 88? They could use a tight end in Detroit.
Yeah, I think Coach Caldwell, you know, he's a pretty good coach, right?
Yeah.
So him being a pretty good coach, he's not going to call me to go over there and ruin his team. Being almost 38 now, I think he's going to let me. And I think he might look out for me, too, and not want me to go out there and hurt myself trying to keep up with the young fellows out there now.
Desmond, back in 1996, when you were still at Wake Forest, you guys played Northwestern second week of the season. They were ranked number 13 at the time. You got a touchdown pass to beat those guys with 51 seconds left in the game. Where does that highlight rank in your all-time highlights list?
You know what? Especially college, that ranks right up there. If not the biggest, I really can't think off the top of my head right now a bigger catch in my college career, because I think that was the year that they actually went to the Rose Bowl.
Right.
And beyond that, when I see Coach Fitz, I could kind of rub that in his face, as you know, when I see him around town now. So, but he always have a good comeback. He'll tell me, well, that's one of the few games that y'all won this year, so congratulations. So we have a good time talking about that. But, one of the most memorable catches in my college career.
When you were at Wake Forest, you guys had some tough battles against Appalachian State, probably a college that doesn't get enough recognition for what a good football program they have. Did those guys surprise you with how good they were?
You know what? We went from a high to a low.
Sorry.
We play Appalachian State three times while I was at Wake Forest, and they actually beat us twice. And the thing about it is that when they came down to play us, it was their Super Bowl, it was their Rose Bowl, so to speak.
Yeah.
And because they were playing against a Division I school, and they were 1AA at the time. Same thing when they beat Michigan. I mean, they get up for that game, and did they surprise us? No, they didn't surprise us. We knew how good they were, because we had a history of playing against them. And they had a couple NFL guys on that team. Was it Dexter Coakley that played Appalachian State back then? And they had a cornerback that actually went to the NFL off of that defense. I don't know if it was Coakley. It was a linebacker that they had, an undersized linebacker. But pretty good teams back then. And like I said, they beat us a couple times, two out of three times while I was there at Wake Forest. So, yeah, we had some pretty good battles.
When you were at Wake, you were actually a wide receiver, right? Didn't you get switched over to tight end after you joined? Were drafted by the Broncos.
Right. I went into the draft as a tight end, but my whole collegiate career was at wide receiver.
So, you know, why the switch to tight end? You know, particularly when you got to Denver. I mean, they already had Shannon Sharp and Dwayne Coswell, and you know, the guy that joined us last week, Byron Chamberlain, was already on their roster. Why did they want to move you to tight end? Did we lose him? I think we lost him. Well, hopefully Desmond can call back in. you know, here quickly. You know, Bob, it's interesting. When you see a guy of his size, it makes sense to me that they moved him to tight end. But, boy, he had such great success as a wide receiver. I got to wonder if, you know, now – you know, if he came into the league now, if they would move, if they would still make that move to tight end or try to take advantage of the great size he has. And he's back here with us. Sorry, Desmond, we're sorry we lost you. But as I was just mentioning to Bob, it seems like you had such great success at the wide receiver position, and Denver already had Shannon Sharpe and Dwayne Coswell and Byron Chamberlain at tight end. Why did they make the switch to you and move you inside to play at tight end?
Well, when I graduated from college, I was 250 pounds, and I ran a 4.7 40. So it was a natural switch. It was something that my whole entire senior year in at Wake Forest, I knew that would be something that was going to happen if I was going to play in the NFL. I mean, it was a great receiver in college, but you know, you got to have a little bit more speed as a receiver in the NFL. Lavelle Pinckney was a guy out of Texas that came before me, and I think he
We're starting to lose you again, Desmond. I think you're starting to digitize a little bit on us.
Okay, I'm sorry, because I'm actually talking to you guys while I'm moving, but yeah, you just don't find 250-pound receivers in the NFL.
So, you know, if you look at the tight ends, you know, nowadays, guys like Gronkowski or Jimmy Graham, you know, guys that are probably similar in stature to what you were then, when you look at, you know, the success that those guys have, you know, if you had come along maybe a few years later, do you see yourself sort of playing in that similar type of role as those two guys?
Possibly. I think, honestly, those guys have probably a little bit better talent than I had. They're faster, they're bigger, they're stronger. So I like to think these tight end. But to say Jimmy Graham and my guy up in New England, would I have been that? I don't know. I like what they do. I like the way they revolutionize the position once again, taking the baton from Tony Gonzalez and kind of carried it forward for tight ends. I like the fact that they're getting tight ends paid a little bit more now. But right. Could I have done that? I don't know.
Bob, questions for Desmond?
Yeah, Desmond, I always like to ask anyone who played in Denver a two-part question. When you left Wake Forest, Desmond, to go to Denver, I know their training camp was at the University of Northern Colorado. Part one is, did you have trouble yourself getting used to the altitude? Part two, when you were all set in that system, did the Broncos always use the altitude as kind of an advantage over their opponents?
You know, it takes about 2 or 3 weeks to get acclimated to the altitude out there. So doing those workouts in the off season, that got me ready for camp. So it wasn't a problem. But to answer your second question, yes, I believe Mike Shanahan used to use the stat over the last 20 or 25 years or whatever it was, the Denver Broncos had the best home record. That's not by accident. It's because when people come out there, they find it hard to catch their breath. And that's something that you don't even have to try to use it to your advantage. It's just intrinsic that is going to be to your advantage because of where you're at, and the other teams don't have enough time to come out and get adjusted to that altitude. So yeah, it's definitely an advantage. And going back out and playing in Denver, yes, it is real, and it is an advantage to them.
And Desmond, Chris knows that tight ends are among my favorite players on the football field because of how many things they need to know, how many things they're asked to do. I guess it's kind of an automatic answer for you, but do these guys have to be some of the more cerebral guys on the football field?
I like you more and more now because I don't think people really appreciate the tight end position enough for everything that we have to do, because besides the quarterback and maybe the center, We probably have the most responsibility because we have to act as an offensive lineman, so we got to know all the protections. And then we have to be a receiver, so we got to know all the routes and all the route combinations and conversions and hots and all of that kind of stuff. And then sometimes they put us in motion, and now we have to be the lead blocker for the running back. So now we have to know all the blocking schemes up front and know the protections also, because sometimes we're in the backfield as a protector. There's no other position on the football field that has to know all of that stuff. So, yes, if you're not a thinking man, you cannot play – you can't play professional football at all, but it takes it another level when you have to play the tight end position, because you kind of have to know the entire offense. You have to know where everybody is at and understand the entire offense. The receivers, they could just go out and run routes and know their hots. They don't have to know protections. The running backs, they have a limited set of routes that they have to know. The offensive linemen, they don't have to – they just got to know protections and blocking schemes, but we have to know all of that. So yes, and I appreciate you bringing that up.
Desmond, you became a major receiving factor for the Bears in 2006, the year you guys went on to the Super Bowl. Late in that season against the Bucks, you had your first game where you got double-digit targets. You had over 100 yards receiving. You had a couple of touchdowns. After that game, did you go up to Lovie Smith and, you know, and just say, you know, hey, look, see what happens when you throw the ball to me?
Hey, give me the opportunity, I'll make the plays. That was always my thing. And after that game, oh, yeah, you know, you always want the ball, especially when you have the ability to make plays and catch the ball. If you're worth anything to your team, you're a guy that always wants to be there to make the plays. And I never shied away from if they asked me, will a play that they were thinking about calling that was going to come my way, would it work? Absolutely. Every time, just throw me the ball. So that was probably the best game of my NFL career. And Rex is my guy. We made some plays out there just freelancing that game also. Just, you know, stuff broke down, and I broke one way, and Rex kind of knew where I was going and got the ball to me. I actually watched that game about 3 months ago in my garage when it was snowing outside just to make me feel good.
There you go. Desmond, before we let you go, let our listeners know how they can follow you both online and over social media.
What are my handles? Instagram and Twitter, I believe both are at DesClark88, and that's D-E-Z, Clark88. I think Facebook is pretty simple. Just look me up, Desmond Clark. It's one or two fake accounts out there, but I think once you go on there and look at the different accounts, you'll see which one is mine, because I have a lot of personal stuff on there as well as family pictures and all that kind of stuff. If it's the one just with all the football stuff on it, it's probably not mine.
Okay. Well, Desmond, thank you so much for taking time out of your night to be a part of the show. We hope you come back and join us sometime. So many other things we'd love to get your insights on, talk to you a little bit more about your, you know, both your college and your pro career, plus, you know, like I said, get some insights on what's going on with respect to the game now. But you're fantastic. Thanks for being a part of the show.
Hey, you guys got my number anytime. Reach out, and if I'm available, I'll certainly do it.
All right. Take care, Desmond.
Thank
all the best
you.
To you and your family.
All right. Thank you. Have a good night.
You too.
Good night.
Good stuff, you know, Bob, and, you know, so, like I say, so much I wanted to get into with Dez, you know, just interesting, you know, that, again, played the Colts in Super Bowl 41 down in Miami. That game was played in the rain. I was kind of curious what it was like, you know, when you get up, you know, finally get the opportunity to play in a Super Bowl and you get up and it's raining outside. What's going through your mind? Like, really? I finally get in the Super Bowl and it's going to rain?
Yeah. People forget how durable he was, Chris, for a guy to play 12 years in the league, and he played some smash-mouth football. I think of a guy who played so long in Soldier Field, it just hurts saying it. So that's a guy that probably played twice as much as the average lifespan of NFL player. So, you know, he kept in good shape. And we'll get into that the next time we speak with him.
Absolutely right. Before we get to our next guest, Ronnie Brown, who's hanging on the line for us, I want to give a shout-out to our good friend Renee Schull at Integrated Play. Like you hear us say all the time on this show, if you're either already in job transition or you want to be in job transition, go to integratedplay.org online and see what Renee can do to help you. We all want to do business and take advice from someone who actually has our best interests at heart and who we can trust. And you're not going to find someone who fits that description any better than Renee Schell at Integrated Play. She's smart, she's talented, and the kind of person you want to work with and have working for you. She is doing some really great things for some of our guests who have been in transition from being pro athletes and are now getting into the job market. I'm telling you, folks, she is just the very best. There isn't another way to describe Renee. If you work with her for 2 minutes, you're going to understand why we say that every single week on this show. If you're an athlete or anybody in the job market, do yourself a favor and reach out to Renee. You're going to be very glad you did. Go to integratedplay.org online and give her a follow on Twitter at integratedplay. All right, now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line is Ronnie Brown. Let me remind you a little bit about Ronnie's background. He's from Rome, Georgia, played his high school ball just a couple of exits north of me right now up in Cartersville High School, which is about a half an hour north of Atlanta, but like I say, it's like two exits north of me from where I'm sitting right now. Played his college ball at Auburn, where he was a two-time All-SEC running back and the Citrus Bowl MVP in 2003. Was a first-round draft pick, the number two overall pick by the Dolphins in 2005. Played in the NFL since 2005 with the Dolphins, Eagles, Texans, and Chargers. Finished up his season last year back in San Diego, and we are certainly glad to have him with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Ronnie, Chris, and Bob, thanks for coming back on the show.
Hey, Chris and Bob, how y'all doing?
Hi, fantastic, good, Ronnie. Good, how you doing, my friend?
I'm doing well. I appreciate y'all for having me.
Ronnie, as a guy from, you know, this part of Georgia, like I say, not far from where I'm at right now, how often do you get back to the Rome and Cartersville area?
Well, I get back fairly enough. Like, I think, you know, my parents still live there, so, and I still have a lot of family in Cartersville. So I get back, you know, as much as possible, especially in the off season when time is permitting and, you know, I can get around and hang out and just kind of relax a little bit.
So from being from around this area, how in the world did Georgia and Georgia Tech let, a hometown kid like you get away and go over to Auburn?
Well, you know, Georgia Tech was too close, and unfortunately they were in the wrong conference. And, you know, Georgia, I think I just wanted to do something different. And, you know, I think a lot of people from our high school and in the area tend to go to Georgia. So I just wanted to kind of venture out and do my own thing and, you know, see what else was going on.
So Auburn had a bit of a down season last year by their standards, I would think. Ronnie, finishing 8-5, they seemed to struggle really defensively, particularly the last couple of games against Alabama and Wisconsin. How do you feel about, you know, where they're at and where they're headed going into, you know, as you project into the, you know, the 2015 season?
I think they're doing well. They're headed in the right direction. I was able to go down 2 weeks ago and watch a spring practice. I think it's going to help, you know, bring Muschamp back and, you know, his defensive guys that he's bringing back in, Tavares Robinson and, you know, those guys. And I think the offense is going to continue to do what they've been doing. That's putting up points and moving the football and creating a lot of yards. So, and I think that's just going to be able to, you know, create some balance on the field. And I think that's going to be trouble when it's hard to score and you got a team that can score a lot of points.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, we've talked to so many guys about, you know, the great college rivalries, particularly, you know, when you look at, you know, the old days with Ohio State and Michigan and what that week is like. From your perspective, you know, the Alabama-Auburn week and the Iron Bowl, what's it like around the Auburn campus when it's Alabama week?
It's just crazy. Like, I can't even put it into words. Like, you see RVs and people pulling up and they're camping out all through the week. They pull up on campus on Mondays and, you know, the game's not until Saturday, and you see, you know, all these cars, and then the game day, you know, we actually come back into town. We used to stay in LaGrange the night before when I was there. I think now they stay in Montgomery, but, you know, just to be driving back on the campus and see all those cars and all those fans and, you know, the stuff that people do and how big it is to them, you know, it's definitely a sight to see, and if you haven't seen it or had a chance to experience it, I think that's something that you would definitely have to experience.
During your time at Auburn, you guys only lost to Alabama once. So what's it like, you know, on campus for you, you know, the next day following an Iron Bowl victory?
Well, you know, that's bragging rights for the state, first of all. And, you know, a lot of people pay attention to that. And, you know, especially in Alabama, you know, I think that's divides households, and people are pretty strict about, you know, whether it's Alabama or Auburn. There's no, you know, no in between. You can't straddle the fence on that argument. So, It's definitely a big thing. And just on campus, you know, everybody knows how big it is. Everybody talks about it. You know, it's weird because even before the season starts, everybody talks about Alabama. It's like, you know, are you going to beat Alabama this year? And we haven't even played the first game. So that just lets you know how big and, you know, the importance of that game is.
Bob, questions for Ronnie?
Yeah, Ronnie, throughout your career, I've always considered you a power back, but one with speed. I mean, to have 3 years in your career where you rushed for more than 900 yards, you got to be able to have some speed. And I was just wondering, from the time you were a rookie to even up to last year, were you always concentrating on increasing your speed, or did you get to a point, Ronnie, where it was, I'm not going to get any faster, now it's got to be all about technique?
Well, I think it was a mixture. You know, I try to mentally approach the game as I want to be as well prepared as I can be, and that's in all aspects, whether it's, you know, not being able to be labeled as a first down running back, a second, first and second down guy, or a third down guy, a guy that can only carry the football. I wanted to be able to be available in every aspect, whether it was first or second down or third down, and, you know, picking up blitzes and those type of things, and, you know, really make sure that I was on point in the cerebral process of the football game. And then from the physical aspect, I think it's just as big to be, you know, in the best shape you can be in, because it's a long season. You play 4 preseason games, sometimes 5, depending on the Hall of Fame game. And then you have a 16-game season if you don't make the playoffs. So, you know, knowing that it's a long process and it's a long season, and if you want to have any longevity, you got to make sure that you stay on top of it. And, you know, as far as the speed stuff, I wanted to make sure that was a part of it. But at the same time, I wanted to make sure I was as strong as possible and, you know, as limber, and make sure that everything else was, all the I's were dotted and T's were crossed as well.
And, Ronnie, I've always been impressed by your ability to catch the ball out of the backfield. I mean, you were consistently more than 30 catches per year. I think you had about 50 just a couple years ago in San Diego. The way the game is played now, Ronnie, is it really, really, really important for a guy to be able to catch balls, even if he's a running back?
Oh, definitely, especially the way the game has evolved. You know, now, even just at the tight end position, whereas, you know, they're getting these guys that are former basketball players, and, you know, it used to be bigger guys. You're going to run the ball 35 times. Most of the running backs are 220, 230, 240 pounds. So, you know, it wasn't as big then. But now you got these tight ends where, you know, they've revolutionized the game as far as guys like Antonio Gates, Jimmy Graham, and, you know, so those guys that are able to jump and catch the football and, you know, spread the field. So, you know, you got those guys. So when you get into the new systems, now it's a difference, because now it's a lot of passing, and it's pretty much pass heavy and pass influence. So if you want to be available, because most teams are using 2 backs, and you want to try to utilize and get in as much as you can, you got to be able to be versatile and, you know, not only carry the ball in certain situations, but as well catch it out of the backfield and be a threat in that aspect as well.
Ronnie, you started off last season with the Texans, and then the Chargers needed you when they had some injuries at running back. You finished out your season there with San Diego. Are you going to be back in 2015?
I'm actually a free agent, you know, so I'm not sure what's going to happen. Like I said, I just want to be prepared, and, you know, when I do get that opportunity, make sure that, you know, I'm available and, you know, I can be an attribute to the football team wherever I'm going, or, you know, wherever I'm at.
There's been some rumors kind of swirling around now about Phillip Rivers and the future of the, you know, of the San Diego Chargers, perhaps, you know, relocating to L.A. First, do you think there's a chance that the Chargers actually make good on the threat and leave San Diego and build a joint stadium with the Raiders? And do you think Phillip Rivers makes good on his threat to say, I don't want to move to L.A.?
You know, it's hard to say, because with this game of football that we play, it's so hard to really say this is going to happen and this is not going to happen. You know, you see guys that are so big part of an organization like Peyton Manning, and he ends up on another team. So if you know it can happen to Peyton Manning, it can happen to anybody. And just knowing that, you know, it is the league and it's a business to it, you know, you never know what you're going to get. So, you know, it's hard for me to just say this isn't going to happen, this is going to happen. because there's so many changes on a yearly basis that, you know, you can't never really be accurate in that.
Right.
And but as far as Phillip, I think, you know, it's I think, you know, he's a Southern guy. He's from Alabama. He's a real homie guy. He has a big influence on guys in the locker room. You know, he's a positive role model in all aspects, whether it's the football field or in his daily life, his daily walk. So, you know, it's hard to say, but at the same time, he does have morals and he does, you know, he is a man of his word. So, you know, if he doesn't want to play in L.A., you know, I could see that. But just as much as I can see him playing in L.A., because he can adjust and he's a football player and he's a professional at all times.
In the time that you spent in San Diego, Ronnie, you know, the Chargers have had a great deal of talent. You know, when you look around and, you know, you're playing there and the guys you had on that roster, what's keeping the Chargers from getting over the hump and being a serious contender for a Super Bowl?
Well, unfortunately, this past year, I think just a lot of injuries, and that's a part of the game. You know, I think, you know, you not only have to be good in this league, because all 32 teams have talent. You know, you got to be well coached. You got to have guys that are unselfish in the locker room, that are willing to work together and, you know, put the team above themselves. And then on top of that, you got to be lucky as well. You know, it's hard to go through a 16-game season without having any injuries or, you know, going through any turmoil at some point in the season.
So to your point about, you know, injuries, and Ronnie, you've been in the game, you know, about 10 years now. Is it a safer game now due to the rules changes and everything that's, you know, taken place in the last few years? Is it a safer game than when you came into the league?
I think it is, and I think that's the focus on safety. But at the same time, it's still football. It's only so much you can do. When you get guys running into one another at the pace and at the strength that they have, you know, it's hard not to get hurt. So, you know, you can only prevent so much, but at the same time, you know, it is what it is. It's just football, and, you know, unfortunately, there's going to be some injuries.
Bob, more for Ronnie?
Ronnie, when you look at your resume, you've played for some guys that have been considered great coaches, a la Nick Saban and Andy Reid. I was just wondering, at any level, even going back to your young days growing up, what coach do you think has prepared you for life, perhaps out of football, more than any other?
You know, I've been fortunate. I've been around a lot of guys that had a positive influence outside of, you know, my household. You know, I had a guy in Bruce Taylor when I was young. He was always big on discipline. And, you know, tucking your shirt in, we had to wash our cleats or clean our cleats before games. You know, when I was in high school, I had my baseball coach. You know, he was big on that and, you know, being a professional and handling yourself certain ways. When I got to college, Coach Tuberville was big on, you know, not just the athletic part of it, but he always wanted to make sure that we went to class on the academic side. And then just in the NFL, you know, just everybody's kind of rubbed off. And I try to look at everybody for what it is and, you know, not get any preconceived notions of anybody, whether it's through rumors or anything, and form my own opinion about people and base it on how they treat me. And I've been able to take a lot of stuff from a lot of people and positive and just kind of learn from it. And, you know, I think life is a learning process, and that's just, you know, just how you look at it. You know, if you look at it in a positive way, you know, there's something good that's going to come out of it. And even when things don't go your way, you know, there's a learning process from that as well.
And if and when, Ronnie, your playing days do come to an end, do you have your sights on anything specific that you'd like to become involved with?
Well, I graduated in communications at Auburn, so I would love to get into broadcasting or, you know, doing something to where I can stay close to the game and I can still, you know, see that competitive spirit and feed that competitive spirit in myself, as well as just being able to, you know, be around what I love. If I can't do it anymore physically, you know, mentally, I like to still be around it.
Well, I'll tell you what, Ronnie, you'd be an outstanding broadcaster because, you know, every time you come on this show, you've got your great stories, and we enjoy it so much. Thank you for taking some time out of your night, and we certainly wish you the best. If you know, you decide you want to play another year or so, then, you know, then God bless you. We hope that someone picks you up and you get to carry on with your NFL career. If not, like I say, I know you're going to be an outstanding broadcaster, and I'm sure we'll turn on the TV sometime, whether it's on ESPN or the NFL channel or Fox, and we're going to see Ronnie Brown sitting at a desk talking some football.
I thank you. I appreciate it. And it's truly an honor for me to always be on. And I, you know, thank you for keeping me in mind. And I just enjoy it. I appreciate it.
All right. Thank you, Ronnie. Thanks for being a part of the show tonight. We look forward to catching up soon. And all the best to you and your family.
Okay. Thank you. Have a good one.
All right. You too, Ronnie.
Take care.
Ronnie Brown. Bob, I tell you. Ronnie, outstanding, and I mean it sincerely. I mean he's always so great when he comes on the show. He's got enthusiasm in his voice. I can always hear the smile in Ronnie Brown's voice, and I think that's going to translate great if he decides to get on the other side of the mic.
Yeah, not only is he one of these, we have such a multitude of many people that go right from the gridiron into the booth, Chris, but he has the training and background and personality to do it. We hope him. Like to see him get a job where he can show all these things to the public. He's a great guy.
Absolutely right. And I tell you what, Bob, before we start to wrap this thing up, you know, Robin Cole, Steelers legendary linebacker, had some things come up, but he is actually hanging on the line with us. I'm going to get Robin in here for a minute, maybe chat for a moment or two, and then hopefully get to have him back on the show with us another time. Good evening, Robin.
Hey, what's going on, guys?
How are you tonight, my friend?
It's been fantastic. Hey, I'm going to tell you the truth. I got hung up cleaning up the house. I just got here from Maui, man. Somebody had to do it. You go over to Hawaii and 85 degrees on an average. Watch the whales float around. Every once in a while, you see a pretty girl walk by. I had a fantastic time. I got home, and I got back, and I started working around here, answering messages, and then the basketball game was on. I said, I'm starting to watch the basketball game, and all of a sudden I see this email, text message. I said, oh, golly, I forgot about the show. I am very sorry about that to all the fans and you guys. Look forward to getting together with you next week.
Yeah, absolutely. We'd like to hopefully get some time with you next week and have you on the show.
Yep.
Robin, I'm a huge Steelers fan, so you know, I've been looking forward to the opportunity to talk to you. You had such a great career and you did so many great things for Steelers Nation, and you brought so much joy to us, particularly, you know, the couple of Super Bowls that you were a part of in the 70s and the great career that you had, the Pro Bowl player. First of all, thank you for all of that, and hopefully we get the opportunity to spend a little more time with you next week.
We sure will. I look forward to it.
All right. Take care, Robin.
Right.
We'll catch up
with you
next week.
All right.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Yeah, I tell you what, Bob, you know, the opportunity to talk to Robin Cole is something that I've been looking forward to. Unfortunately, didn't get to do it tonight, but we'll get to do it, spend some time with him next week. But you want to talk about a great player, and, you know, our good friend Andy Russell was that right outside linebacker through the first two Super Bowls of the 70s, and then Robin Cole came along after that to step in there, particularly in the Super Bowl against the Rams in 79. That we actually played in 1980 in January of 80, but great player, and I get to look forward to it for another week.
Yeah, he, again, very durable guy, Chris, and I remember the last year of his career in New York, I saw him play.
Right.
He actually played in every game that year and played well. So, but look, we'll catch it. We'll give him a break. If I'm in Maui, Chris, and I'm coming back here, my mind's not on football either. So, I'm sorry. Hawaii does things with your mind that you can't get across to people, but we look forward to talking to him.
Yeah, and you had, you know, you have the memory of being in Hawaii back in the day, and then, you know, it's a little salt in the wound, I guess, the memory now, you know, and then him coming back from Maui tonight. But for all the things like we talk about at the beginning of the show that you and everyone in the Northeast are dealing with, from the cold and the snow and all that sort of thing. But I'm sure hearing that he was out there brings some good memories for you.
No matter where you're going, Chris, from the Hawaii airport, no matter where you're taking off, it's the hardest thing you'll ever do, leaving Hawaii to go back somewhere else. That's all I'll tell people, and people that have done it know what I'm talking about.
Absolutely right. I'm sure that's exactly true. All right, Bob, it's time for us to put a bow on another episode of Thursday Night Tailgate. Great job out of you tonight, my friend, as always. As much as we had a great time doing the special event last Saturday night, and it's always great to have Ange as part of the show and that sort of thing, but we always miss when you're not there in the right-hand chair, my friend.
Well, it's an honor to talk with such great guys on the show every week, Chris, and the lineup just keeps getting stronger. We love talking to these guys, and they're They're just terrific gentlemen.
Yeah, absolutely right. And our apologies, we had some technical difficulties at the start of the show, and I guess we had some guys dropping on and off the line, but we persevered, Bob, and it's still you know, great to get the opportunity to talk to the gentleman that we've had on the show tonight. And next week, who else is going to be joining us? Well, former BC Lions defensive back, current free agent, Dante Marsh is going to be back on the show. What a great career he's had with the Lions and up in the CFL. And he's another guy like Ronnie Brown that we hope gets to continue to play. So we look forward to talking to Dante. We'll have our good friend Warren Moon back on the show to recap the wonderful Unstoppable Gale I mentioned a moment ago that we were a part of last Sunday. Honored to be there and watch Warren be honored. It was a great event, and like I said at the top, so much fun with all the great guests that we had. Robin Cole, obviously, going to be back with us. Another great Steeler, former Steelers and Jaguars Pro Bowl tackle, Leon Searcy, going to be back on the show. And NBC Sports radio producer Jason Grohman is going to join us. Jason has become a great friend that we've gotten to know via Twitter, and then has had me on his show out in L.A. So my gratitude to Jason for what a great supporter he's become of Thursday Night Tailgate. So I look forward to the opportunity to talk to Jason next week. And then, as always, our regular 12th man segment with David Meltzer, and I'm sure he'll have a special guest joining him as well. So it's going to be another great show. We hope you'll come back and join us as well. I want to remind everyone, how can you follow us on Twitter? You hear about everybody else. How can you follow us? Well, I am at CT Mascaro. Bob is at Bob_Lazzari, and the show is at TNT Podcast. Plus, also check out our Facebook page. Give us a like. That's important to us, too. You can find us on Facebook, as well as you can stay up to date with who some of our future guests are going to be. You can stream or download any of our archive episodes for free from our site, ThursdayNightTailgate.com, as well. Bob, take us home, my friend.
It's an honor, Chris, always to be on the airwaves with you. And, of course, our thanks go out to our announcer, Joe LaGenusa, for the great job he does with our weekly intro and ads. And to Kyle Turley, Tim Pickett, and all our friends over at Gridiron Records for their partnership and our upcoming outro music. On behalf of myself and Chris, thanks to everyone out there for listening tonight. We appreciate you the most. Until next week, good night, Kevin. Keep fighting.
Coming down the mountain, I take a breath to say, can't tell the day or time, but I know this day.